We're now going to take a look at the second half of our journey through the American Revolution and concentrate, not totally, on the military aspects of the American Revolution. It was a war between two very unequal parties. Of course, the American colonists, not totally united, not well supplied, and in some instances, not well led. On the other hand, you have the primary military power in the entire world. That, of course, being Great Britain and the British Empire. Their navy is no doubt number one. Their soldiers have been victorious in years after years of warfare on the European continent, and some obviously in America, as we saw with a series of French and Indian Wars. They are well supplied, but again, not particularly well led in some instances. And that is going to make the difference. Early on April 18th, 1775, two lights are put up in the old north tower of a church in Boston. That is the signal for two individuals, Paul Revere and William Dawes, who will ride cross country to warn John Hancock and Sam Adams, who are hiding in Lexington or Concord. And in both those places, but primarily Concord, the stores of American arms used to supply the Minutemen were being hit. And those two men and those arms were the goal of the 1,800 British who are now being ferried across the Charles River onto land, and where they will march approximately 20 miles to their goal. On that April morning, the following day, April 19th, 1775, that's when the shot heard around the world is going to be fired. It will leave six or seven colonists dead on the field and others flee. And now confidently, the British are going to march on to Concord. But there, it's not going to be such an easy task, because when they wind up in Concord, they're going to find that they are faced not with a few people, rather thousands. At Concord Bridge, a couple hundred of them will meet the British. Some colonists will die, but more British will. And now they got to turn around, not having found their arms that they were after, and march back to Boston. By the time they get back to Boston, they will have been hassled all the way back by over 5,000 to 7,000 colonists, all of them from Massachusetts and surrounding New England areas. And now over 11,000 of them will begin a siege of Boston. And now it is the British who are confined. And this begins the American Revolution. When all this is taking place, the Second Continental Congress will be held in Philadelphia, May 1775, in the area known as Carpenter's Hall. Now the Second Continental Congress, now keep in mind, though there is a quote unquote president of Congress, and this happens to be John Hancock, by the way, he is not the leader. He simply runs the meeting. He has no more power than anybody else to order anything. So it is a disparate group that meets there. Each colony has given different directives to its representatives, and oftentimes those directives are as different as the colonies, meaning they are not totally united in what they want to do. They will organize an army and a navy. They will authorize the supplies for that. Of course, how they pay for them, that is a completely different thing. And then they are going to appoint an overall commander in chief. As we all know, it's George Washington. Washington would be nominated by John Adams. Now, of course, they're two founding fathers, but the important thing to remember is this. Washington is a Virginian. Adams is from Massachusetts. Adams has no military background. Washington obviously did in the French and Indian War. Not necessarily successful, but nonetheless, he had two qualities. One, military experience, and one more important than any of that. And that was his honesty. That was the one thing that the people there at that convention could universally agree on. So why did the man from Massachusetts push for the gentleman from Virginia? Well, the obvious reason. He, and we're talking about Adams now, did not want this to seem as if it's strictly a Massachusetts rebellion. This is an American rebellion. And this unites two of the largest colonies on opposite ends of the geographic spectrum, Washington and Virginia, and of course, Massachusetts. Washington will control or command a number of people now from New England. As you see, New England wanted independence. The middle colonies, they wanted to kind of put this thing to a close. Let's see if we can make nice with the king and parliament and end this whole thing. The South was as mixed as the middle colonies and New England were. Some were for total independence, as you will see shortly, and some were not. And within those colonies, of course, there were different groups. There were the very wealthy, many of whom wanted independence, and some of whom did not. There were the middle class, and of course, there were those at the bottom of the scale. And each of them had their different reasons for favoring or disfavoring independence. But what many of them felt and what many of them believed is that from a military standpoint, this was going to consist of one general action. This would be one big battle and it would be over. The problem was, number one, the American army, as it was not large enough to sustain a battle against the well-trained and well-blooded British. So then it would fall to the militia. The problem with that was, and it would be seen throughout the Revolution, militia, at times heroic, but at most times not dependable. They were not disciplined, oftentimes not well led by anybody with military experience, and their loyalty to the cause was based more on environment than anything else. And what do I mean by that? Well, 90% of these guys, and maybe more, were farmers. They had the plant and they had the harvest. So the times that they could be away from that were few and far between. And then you had the fears of Congress. Fear of what? Losing? No. They were afraid that they just might win. And if they did, would that put another tyrant in charge? Would George Washington, for example, turn out to be not the great man on the white horse who rides to this salvation of his country and then goes back to his farm? No, that he would become a Napoleon, as we will see later, and take over the country. So after that battle, the Bridge in Concord, then you will see as the colonists surround the British in Boston, Washington, after his appointment, will make his way up from Philadelphia to New York in order to take control. He will not see, again, this is 1775, he will not see his beloved Mount Vernon for 8 years. He does not take a salary. The only thing he asks for is expenses. But in the meantime, again, you had this split nature of the Continental Congress in terms of what did it want. They will send something that will become known as the Olive Branch Petition. That petition as you see there, Your Majesty's ministers. We are abhorrent to some of the things. You're still faithful colonists. Our own particular misfortunes are accounted by us only as parts of our distress. If you read through that, you will see that they are looking at the king as their savior. They don't see this as something that the king is opposed to. They see their enemy as parliament, and they're asking the king to intercede and read their petition. What they don't know is that the king, after the shots fired at Lexington and Concord, has made it clear that they must submit or die. And it is the king that is pushing much of this. So the olive branch petition flies in the face of what they're really doing. And you've got Washington, who's trying to balance all of this out, this schizoid Congress and the bloodlust of the colonists who have experienced Lexington and Concord and want the British out. Now, advantages and disadvantages. It's no different in a game as it is in war. Great Britain, huge economy, world empire, well-established government, a professional army, the world's largest and best navy. However, as you see there, they do have a disadvantage, a huge one. The long lines of communication, they are far, far away from supply and from immediate feedback as to what to do. And they are fighting on foreign soil, something that many of them are not used to. And we will find that same thing when we, 100 and some years later, will embark upon a war in a far off place called Vietnam. The American colonies, yep, home field advantage. And they've got a ready market of resources. The problem is, how do they pay for all of that? Yeah, they're fighting on their home turf, but again, sometimes an advantage can be a disadvantage and vice versa. For example, in terms of British soldiers, they're fighting far away from home. So if they don't like it, where the heck are they going to go? They can desert, but go where? With the Americans, yeah, they're fighting on their home turf, which means if they don't like it, they can go home. So home field may not be quite what it seems to be. Disadvantages for the Americans, again, you see there, weak government, a Continental Congress unsure of itself. They have an economy that has been in the grasp of the British mercantilist system. There were no real industries because they had been forbidden. They had been very dependent on the British to buy their goods and for currency. They didn't have any of their own. Disunity. One third of the population, it's estimated by John Adams, are Tories or loyalists. They favor the crown. Others could care less. And then the others are the true patriots, the people who believe in the American cause, whatever that may be. The British Army, well-disciplined, will be led by Sir William Howe. It will be his brother, Admiral Howe, who will be in charge of the Navy. So they are like hand in glove. And initially now, they are well equipped. What did the British want to do? Well, let's get this over with. New York City, take Philadelphia, grab George Washington, and rely on the South, where they believe there are strong loyalist sentiment. Looking at that strategy, there are some obvious, but not to the British, mistakes. Number one, they look at war as a game of chess. Capture the king, in this case, the capital, and the war would be over. And as time went on, that was not the case. They're going to capture Philadelphia. And what do? Well, we move the capital to Lancaster or York, Pennsylvania. eventually Annapolis, until it goes back to Philadelphia. George Washington defeating him? Well, they may beat him in a number of battles, but they never truly defeat him. And Washington will become the de facto face of the American Revolution. It is he who needs to be taken, not Philadelphia. We will run into that same mistake early on when we fight the American Civil War in the 1860s. And we want to capture Richmond when it was really General Robert E. Lee who we should have been after. The Continental Army, led by Washington, inexperienced, poorly equipped, and as I've already explained, very difficult to keep troops. Washington did not want to rely on militia. He felt that in order to beat the British, they needed a full-time professional army. And that, of course, was Congress's greatest fear, because a full-time professional army would be the instrument of a dictator. So you had two groups who wanted the same thing, but at opposite ends of the spectrum. Boston. Boston would be the central military point in the very beginning. And it is there in Boston where Washington would go to take over. We all are familiar with the Battle of Bunker Hill. It is one of the largest military engagements throughout the entire American Revolution. A couple thousand colonists situated actually on Breed's Hill, led by General Israel Putnam from Connecticut, would kill over 800 British soldiers who would eventually take it because they take the hill, because the Americans ran out of ammunition. Don't fire till you see the whites of their eyes. But as one British officer said, one more such great victory and we will surely lose the war. So what do we have? For the Americans, Washington wanted a war of attrition. Wear them out, drag it out for as long as possible. Get them tired so they'll go home. Guerrilla tactics. We don't have to win a battle. We just have to wear them down. And above all, make an alliance with one of Britain's enemies, somebody who will gladly fund the military exploits of the colonists. For the British, they wanted to split the colonies in half between North and South, blockade the ports, nothing in, nothing out. In effect, almost starve them of money and supplies. And divide and conquer. Use the Loyalists and Tories as faithful allies. The problem with that was going to be they overestimated the depth of support that the Loyalists would give. John Adams said, one third, one third, one third, one third for it, one third against it, and one third just plain didn't care. What does that mean? Take a look.
Our first order of business.
And our last, if we vote a levy.
Order. Mr. Sims, you will not have the floor. Our first order of business will be an address by Colonel Harry Burwell of the Continental Army. Colonel Burwell.
You all know why I'm here. I'm not an orator. And I would not try to convince you of the worthiness of our cause. I'm a soldier. And we are at war. From Philadelphia, we expect a declaration of independence. 8 of the 13 colonies have levied money in support of a Continental Army. I ask that South Carolina be the 9th.
Massachusetts and Virginia may be at war, but South Carolina is not. Hear, hear.
This is not a war for the independence of one or two colonies, but for the independence of one nation.
And, yes, what nation is that?
An American nation.
There is no such nation, and to speak of one is treason.
We are citizens of an American nation. and our rights are being threatened by a tyrant 3,000 miles away.
Would you tell me, please, Mr. Howard, why should I trade one tyrant 3,000 miles away for 3,000 tyrants 1 mile away? An elected legislature can trample a man's rights as easily as a king can.
Captain Martin, I understood you to be a patriot.
If you mean by patriot, am I angry about taxation without representation? Well, yes, I am. Should the American colonies govern themselves independently? I believe they can, and they should. But if you're asking me, am I willing to go to war with England? Well, then the answer is most definitely no.
This from the same Captain Benjamin Martin, whose fury was so famous during the Wilderness Campaign?
I was intemperate in my youth.
Temperance can be a convenient disguise for fear.
Mr. Middleton, I fought with Captain Martin under Washington in the French and Indian War. There's not a man in this room, or anywhere for that matter, to whom I would more willingly trust my life.
Hear, hear.
There are alternatives to war. We take our case before the king. We plead with him.
Yes, we've tried that.
Well, then we try again and again, if necessary, to avoid a war.
Benjamin, I was at Bunker Hill. The British advanced 3 times, and we killed over 700 of them at point-blank range, and still they took the ground. That is the measure of their resolve. Now, if your principles dictate independence, then war is the only way. It has come to that.
I have 7 children. My wife is dead. Now, who's to care for them if I go to war?
Wars are not fought only by childless men.
Granted. But mark my words. This war will be fought not on the frontier or on some distant battlefield, but amongst us, among our homes. Our children will learn of it with their own eyes. And the innocent will die with the rest of us. I will not fight. And because I will not fight, I will not cast a vote that will send others to fight in my stead.
And your principles?
I'm a parent. I haven't got the luxury of principles.
So, that speech, of course, from the movie The Patriot, highlights the very split personality, if you will, of the colonies and the colonists themselves. Washington will take command on July 3rd, 1775, of the troops surrounding Boston. He takes command of a Continental Army, which, of course, while they're trying to claim victory, an olive branch petition has been sent. It's proffered by Benjamin Franklin, but the king will not even consider it, will not even look at it. This is now past any chance of reconciliation. Colonial unity. Take a look at what Washington, when he arrived at Boston, what he thinks of the New England Patriots, if you will, not the football team. They are an exceedingly dirty and nasty people. Well, there you go. That's going to bring about unity. Now, of course, Washington is going to totally change his mind by the time this war is over. And some of his most reliable commanders are going to be New Englanders, if you will. But in the beginning, Washington was not happy. He had to instill discipline among them, which he did, sometimes quite brutally, by the way. But nonetheless, he was able to bring about a victory in Boston. And the British left. When the British left Boston, there was not a single redcoat left in the continental United States. That was all going to change when King George sends over an army of 35,000, mainly redcoats, but of course would be supplemented by foreign mercenaries. For Washington, you see what he wrote, a war of posts, a defensive war. Avoid a general action. He doesn't want a large-scale battle, which might bring massive defeat. And Washington is going to lose most of the battles that he fights. But though he loses the battles, he is never beaten. The army maintains its status, and he maintains control. Coming to the rescue, in terms of inspiring American public opinion, will be not a victory in the beginning, but a pamphlet by an immigrant named Thomas Paine, who came over here from England around 1773. He's in Philadelphia working at a newspaper when he writes the pamphlet known as Common Sense. He moves to the city of Burlington, Burlington City in New Jersey. And there, Common Sense is written in common language that everybody can understand. Tyranny is not easily conquered. Yet we have this consolation with us that the harder the conflict, the more glorious the triumph. Freedom should be rated. Freedom does not come cheap. 'Tis dearness only that gives everything its value. These are the times, as he will say later, that try men's souls. And it is with this language and that pamphlet that he, Thomas Paine, is able to convince Americans that it is independence that they want, not just British defeat. We have it in our power to begin the world over again. A situation similar to the present hath not happened since the days of Noah until now. Soaring rhetoric. And that was something that Paine would always be good at. But if we look way, way in advance, you're going to find that Paine will always be a revolutionary. He's good at tearing things down, but he's not very good at building them back up. And he's going to become very disappointed in America after the revolution, as we shall see. All of this is going to come to fruition with, of course, the American Declaration of Independence. Declaration of Independence. Primarily authored by that man, Thomas Jefferson. You see some of Jefferson's background there. Was always known as what some people call a wordsmith. He was widely read, great deal of knowledge, exceedingly brilliant. Years later, when John F. Kennedy was president of the United States, he brought together all of the Nobel Prize winners in the United States and had them for lunch in the White House. And as they sat down to lunch, Kennedy stood up in front of them and said, "This room has not seen this much genius since Thomas Jefferson ate here alone." Now think about that. So here he was, part of what becomes known as a Committee of Five, which of course would include Ben Franklin and John Adams. But he would be the primary author. They would be editors, but he would be the author of this document. What did he believe? What are some of the things that he wanted to do? Well, he believed in separation of church and state. He believed that the colonies had the right to overthrow a tyrannical government. There is that social contract theory of Locke's and Rousseau's that's now going to be eloquently explained within the confines of the Declaration. Who did they want to know all this? Well, they wanted independence from England. They wanted an international audience to understand why they were doing this, and in so doing, be able to harvest the support that goes with that. But they had a problem. And that problem, which almost derailed this whole thing, would be the issue of slavery.
Mr. Hughes.
Mr. Jefferson. Nowhere do you mention deep sea fishing rights.
Oh, good God!
It's John
fishing
Adams.
Rights. How long is this piddling to go on? We have been here for 3 full days. We have endured, by my count, 85 separate changes and the removal of close to 400 words. Now, would you whip it and beat it till you break its spirit? I tell you, that document is a masterful expression of the American mind.
If there are no more changes, then I can assume the report of the Declaration Committee has been...
Just a moment, Mr. President.
Look out.
I wonder if we might prevail upon Mr. Thompson to read again a small portion of Mr. Jefferson's declaration. The one beginning, he has waged cruel war.
He is affected, he's combined, he's abdicated, he's plundered, he's constrained, he's excited, he's incited, he's waged cruel war. Here it is. He has waged cruel war against human nature itself and the persons of a distant people who never offended him, captivating and carrying them into slavery in another hemisphere. Determined to keep open a market where men should be bought and sold, he has prostituted
that
his...
That will suffice, Mr. Thompson. I thank you, sir. Mr. Jefferson, I can't quite make out what it is you're talking about.
Slavery, Mr. Rutledge.
Oh, yes. You're referring to us as slaves of the king.
No, sir. I'm referring to our slaves, black slaves.
Oh, black slaves. Why didn't you say so, sir? Were you trying to hide your meaning?
No, sir.
Just another literary license, then.
If you like.
I don't like at all, Mr. Jefferson. To us in South Carolina, black slavery is our peculiar institution and a cherished way of life.
Nevertheless, we must abolish it.
Nothing is more certainly written in the book of fate than that this people shall be free.
I am not concerned with the book of fate
right now, Mr. Jefferson. I'm more concerned with what is written in that little paper there.
That little paper there deals with freedom for Americans.
Oh, really?
Mr. Ack is now calling our black slaves Americans. Are they not?
Yes, they are. They're people, and they're here. If there's any other requirement, I've never heard of it.
They are here, yes, but they are not people, sir. They are property.
No, sir, they are people who are being treated as property. I tell you, the rights of human nature are deeply wounded by this infamous practice.
And see to your own wounds, Mr. Jefferson, for you are a practitioner. Are you not?
I have already resolved to release my slaves.
Which he never does.
And I'm sorry. For you've also resolved the ruination of your personal economy.
Economy, always economy. There's more to this than a filthy purse string, Rutledge. It is an offense against man and God.
It's a stinking business, Mr. Rutledge, a stinking business.
Is it really, Mr. Hopkins? Then what is that I smell floating down from the north? Would that be the aroma of hypocrisy? For who holds the other end of that filthy purse string, Mr. Adams? northern brethren.
Feeling a bit tender toward our slaves. They don't keep slaves.
Oh, no. But they're willing to be considerable carriers of slaves to others. They're willing. For the shilling. Or haven't you heard, Mr. Adams?
Bread.
Clink. Clink.
Glasses to rum, to slaves. Oh, what a beautiful waltz. You dance with us, we dance with you, in molasses and rum and slang. Oh, sail the ships out of Boston, laden with Bibles and rum. Who drinks a toast to the ivory coast? Hail Africa, the slavers have come. New England with Bibles and rum.
Well, there you go. In music, again, the musical was called 1776. Go look it up on YouTube. You see there what was included in the original presentation for the Declaration. He has waged cruel war against human nature, violating its most sacred rights of life, liberty, and the persons of a distant people who never offended him. He has excited domestic insurrection among us. That, as you saw there from John Rutledge, who was the leader of the delegation from South Carolina, was gravely objected to. So already, as we strive for unity and to create a nation, the very pillars that this nation exists on are about to be pulled out from under us and cause the collapse of that nation later. And of course, we're talking about slavery. And the only thing that kept the South would walk out eventually. And until this was removed from the Declaration, which it would be, the South was not going to participate. So there you have it. Slavery was already a tremendous complication in the very existence of the country, in the success or lack thereof, the Revolution. So what were the major points of the Declaration of Independence? All right. Again, the natural right given by God, not from a king, to declare our independence. When in the course of human events, one of the most lyrical lines ever penned by man, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bonds which have connected him with another. There it is, the call for the international audience to pay attention. There is the shot heard around the world. We are given certain unalienable rights. Chief among them, take a look. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. Originally, as we already taken a look at much earlier in the Zoom session, that it was life, liberty, and property that came from John Locke. Jefferson changes it because property is not something that everybody had. Land, though an infinite commodity, was not easily come by. And as such, it looked like we would be discriminating against people, particularly those who didn't own property. So we go with a much more vague, but yet, how could you disagree with it? Pursuit of happiness. So what is one man's happiness is not necessarily another's, which can lead, of course, to conflict. Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. And we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. But, of course, initially it didn't apply to women, Native Americans, and of course, slaves. Major points of the Declaration then, governments get their authority from the consent of the people. There you have it. We take the social contract theory, go all the way back to the Mayflower Compact, and that very idea now appears in this document. Deriving their powers from the consent of the governed, not from anywhere else. When a government abuses its power, the people have the right to overthrow it. Rather strong language. Keep in mind, there are some, Lincoln among them, that treasured the Declaration perhaps more than the Constitution. Whenever any form of government becomes destructive to these ends, it is the right of the people to alter or to abolish it. Now, how is that done? That becomes a central question. They tried, and yet the king would not listen. So again, there's that international audience. Look, we've had patience. We've tried to get them to listen to us. They refuse, thus making what they're doing totally within the scope of human right. So we finally have declared the independence from England, the first step in the creation of a new nation, but it was not a step that was lightly taken. Take a look from the HBO miniseries, John Adams.
A resolution proposed by Mr. Lee. That these colonies are, and of a right ought to be, free and independent states, and that all political connection between them and the country of Great Britain is, and of a right ought to be, totally dissolved.
New Hampshire.
New Hampshire
votes yes. Rhode Island.
Rhode Island votes yes.
Massachusetts.
Massachusetts votes yes.
New York.
New York has yet to receive new instructions from its Constituent Assembly. We therefore respectfully abstain.
Connecticut.
Connecticut votes yes.
New Jersey.
New Jersey votes yes.
Pennsylvania.
Pennsylvania votes yes.
Delaware.
Delaware votes yes.
Virginia.
Virginia votes yes.
Maryland.
Maryland votes yes.
North Carolina.
North Carolina votes yes.
South Carolina.
South Carolina votes yes.
Georgia.
Georgia votes yes.
The vote stands. 12 for independence, none against, with one abstention. Resolution carries.
Now look, listen. No cheers, no jumping up and down, no clapping each other on the back. They sit there in stunned silence because what they are about to do is treason, punishable by death. They sign that declaration, they sign their own death warrants if they lose this war.
When, in the course of human events, it becomes necessary for one people to dissolve the political bands which have connected them with another, and to assume among the powers of the earth the separate and equal station to which the laws of nature and of nature's God entitle them, A decent respect to the opinions of mankind requires that they should declare the causes which impel them to the separation.
We hold these truths to be self-evident, and that all men are created equal, and that they are endowed by their creator with certain...
Now, that would be read on the battlefield by George Washington as they were preparing to meet the British on Manhattan Island. Washington's headaches were just now beginning. So they have a Declaration of Independence. They know what they're fighting for. That does not necessarily mean the country is unified, but Washington's headaches have just begun. The one-third, one-third, one-third that we've discussed. State and colony loyalties, not loyal to a country, because what was that country? They were loyal to their individual states. And so therefore it was difficult to get support from one or the other. Where was money going to come from? No power to tax. So they were going to have to borrow or have it donated. And until the arrival of Baron von Steuben from Germany, the army is poorly trained. And this against the 35,000 man professional army that England is about to land on the continent. Early on, defeats in New York, driven out of that colony and out of the city. New Jersey, chased across New Jersey. This is after the Declaration of Independence. So it doesn't look too good. It's merely a piece of paper with not much bite to it. But the British do Washington a favor. As winter approaches, General Howe does not pursue. He'd rather enjoy the warmth of the buildings in New York than he would the cold of the battlefields in New Jersey and Pennsylvania. So it gives the army a chance to catch its breath and plan. So, Yankee Doodle about to become a dandy. Washington is going to save the revolution with a dramatic crossing of the Delaware on Christmas night, 1776. This famous picture of Washington crossing the ice-choked Delaware was mocked by a lot of historians, including me, because it didn't look to be accurate. This is taking place around 1 or 2 in the morning. You see the light out there surrounding Washington. But what many, including myself, mocked was Washington standing up in that rowboat as the New England Marbleheaders, as they were called, from the town of Marblehead, Massachusetts, rowed these boats across the ice-choked Delaware. Well, in fact, Washington did stand, as it turns out. And his 2,000-man army, along with their horses and guns, would be transported between 2 and 6 in the morning across that ice-choked Delaware. Now, when they recreate this every day or Christmas, if it's too cold, they don't row across. Thank God that wasn't Washington's men's choices. This battle at Trenton, brought to him by a spy that the Hessians, the mercenary soldiers from the area of Hesse in what would become later Germany, they were encamped in Trenton, but not expecting an attack. So Washington doubles back from Pennsylvania across the Delaware River, marches to Trenton, and there will defeat the Hessian army, killing the German commander, the Hessian commander, and taking over 1,200 prisoners while losing very few himself. This will save the American Revolution. Then, a few weeks later, in early January, once again, Washington doubles back and defeats a small British army led by a future foe, a British general who he will face down at Yorktown, but more about him later, but this time at Princeton. Those two battles will re-energize the revolution. It stops the colony of New Jersey from teetering, because it was, and now fully on the side of the revolution. And so the battles will continue. The next one will be in Philadelphia. Washington, who eventually retreats to Valley Forge, is forced to defend the Capitol. He will fight two major battles, one at Brandywine and one at Germantown. Both of these, though British victories, were nip and tuck for the British. As a matter of fact, at Germantown, if it wasn't for the fog, which made his men shoot upon their own, and there wasn't that confusion, they might well have won. But once again, Washington saves his army, and they retreat to Valley Forge, just 20 miles outside of Philadelphia. In the midst of a land of plenty, his army will near starve, but they have not been beaten. And there will be other problems that they will face at Valley Forge. Problems that we will talk about in the next lecture.